Hi, my name is Sophia, and I hope that after this video you'll add one or two books to your reading list. I've been wondering what inspired different writers to create and about reading taste in general. Dostoevsky was quite an avid reader, even by 19th century standards. So, for the past 2 months, I have been reading some of his favorite books. If you're looking for recommendations from someone who was in love with reading, here are some suggestions. I wanted to make a long, long list and to discuss every book in detail, but this would be too overwhelming for you to watch and for me to make, to be honest. So I decided to make this a part one to narrow down this list and to discuss the rest of the books he enjoyed in a follow-up video if you'd be interested in that. I won't spoil his works, I won't spoil the works he enjoyed, so don't worry, you're safe. Let's start with the most obvious influence, and in Dostoevsky's case, the most obvious one, except the Bible, would be Don Quixote. It's one of those books that need no introduction. He loved it so much, he used to call his wife Sancho Panza, and rightly so, because she was more practical and down-to-earth than her husband. This book is so iconic and intimidating that I gave it up twice when I tried to read it when I was younger. My main problem was that I didn't understand who was the target audience, the mix between the jokes and the profound insights about ideals, faith, and societal norms was a bit off-putting at the time. I believed that the narrator was too cruel to the poor fellow. Now my views have changed. I still think that the novel would have been so much better if we removed a few parts that had little to do with the main plot. At the same time, one of those filler episodes was one of my favorite parts in the book, and I imagine others will be your favorites. So which ones do we remove? Perhaps it's just better to leave them alone. If one were to count how many times it was mentioned or alluded to in Dostoevsky's works, I think they would understand a bit better how much it meant to him. In a novel in 9 letters, Don Quixote represented the bond between two families, and returning the book to its rightful owners meant breaking this bond. In Humiliated and Insulted, a character asks another not to think of him as a Don Quixote. In The Idiot, there is an interesting incident related to the book, not to mention the similarities between Mushkin and the knight. I won't even try to count how many times it was mentioned in the writer's diary. I think he discussed it directly in the article A Lie is Saved by a Lie. He wrote, "If the world came to an end and people were asked, what did you understand about your life on earth? Someone could silently hand over Don Quixote. Here is my conclusion about life. Can you condemn me for it? I read it in March, I'll film the reading wrap-up soon enough, and I get why he would say something like that. Some parts are simply perfect. There's a lot of depth to it, and it was definitely one of the best books I read this year, or in my entire life, but not something I'd like to reread. I can see how it influenced Dostoevsky and many other writers, and I hope that you'll give it a try at least, especially if you love The Idiot and your heart is still broken by all the disappointments you've ever had. Perhaps you'll discover that you're a Don Quixote or a Donna. Some people compare themselves to the main character, and it's usually a compliment. Most people can fall in love with someone they've heard or seen, but falling in love with someone you cannot reach, that's something else entirely. That's more like religion. It's a truly tragic story despite all its humor. Getting pleasure from the love you radiate instead of the love you can receive, that's something else. Creating your own reality instead of conforming to the one accepted by others is a skill that most of us lose at some point in life. Anyway, this book will surprise you in one way or another. It's definitely generous in terms of characters, themes, and ideas. In the second part, they'll be discussing the sequel to Don Quixote, written not by Cervantes but some other author. And some readers enjoy the second part even more than the first one. It's definitely a journey you wouldn't want to miss. When someone asked Dostoevsky for recommendations for the children, he usually recommended the books he himself enjoyed at that age. He believed that the impressions of the sublime are necessary in childhood. Let's see which books he enjoyed when he was young. Dostoevsky and his siblings were taught to read by their mother from a collection of religious texts adapted for children, entitled 104 Sacred Stories from the Old and the New Testaments. If you read The Brothers Karamazov, you probably remember that Father Zosima was also taught to read from the same book. Apparently, the children were supposed to memorize it, and it should take them about 1 or 2 years to do so. It had illustrations, questions, and moralities at the end, so I guess it was a bonding experience for the family. When he was much, much older, Dostoevsky wrote to his wife that he was rereading the Book of Job and that he was in painful ecstasy, that he couldn't stop crying. He also mentioned that this book was one of the first ones that affected him deeply as a child. It's so comforting to see that other people, especially the ones you like, could feel such strong emotions while reading, that it wasn't just escapism or entertainment for them. Dostoevsky read quite a lot of writers in his youth, but he would return to them again and again. Although he loved Russian literature, there were quite a lot of foreign writers in his parents' collection. Schiller, Hoffmann, Goethe, Balzac, Hugo, and Walter Scott were among his favorites. I haven't read any works by Walter Scott, but I know that Dostoevsky enjoyed them. He read everything that was available to him. He loved his Waverly novels, especially Waverly, Quentin, Durward, and The Monastery. Thanks to him and the other writers he read at the time, Dostoevsky could borrow different elements and develop them into his own stories. He also staged them, and just like Nyateczka Niezvanova, he imagined himself the hero of every novel he read. Saint Ronan Swell and Ivanhoe even appear in Nyateczka Niezvanova. Dostoevsky loved history and historical novels anyway, and he praised Walter Scott for his educational value. The next author who clearly had a big impact on Dostoevsky was Charles Dickens. At least Humiliated and Insulted has very Dickensian vibes. Dostoevsky also compared Mr. Pickwick to Don Quixote, and he tried to explain why these positively beautiful figures attract the readers. People feel compassion for a beautiful figure which is laughed at and ignorant of its own value, and there's sympathy in the reader. A character from The Adolescent mentioned the old curiosity shop and described the beautiful landscape from there. There's no direct quote. I think he changed a few elements to make it more Dostoevskian. During his exile in Siberia, Dostoevsky asked for David Copperfield, which says a lot about his interest in this great Christian. He spoke of the characters from Charles Dickens and Walter Scott as if they were his intimate friends, that is, according to his daughter, and he asked his wife to read their works to their children. The next author Dostoevsky enjoyed as a child was quite a surprise to me when I discovered it a few years ago. Apparently, Dostoevsky loved Anne Radcliffe. His parents would read her novels to him when he was very young, when he couldn't read, and he would rave about them in his sleep. Her works made him fall in love with Italy. He wanted to visit it from a very young age, and his dream came true. The Mysteries of Udolpho was mentioned in The Brothers Karamazov, and you could find the Italian in his parents' library. Unfortunately, I haven't read any of her novels yet, so I can't recommend you anything in particular. I do know that they're gothic and exciting, and they can seem melodramatic to the modern-day reader. I might be wrong, though. Grigorievich was a Russian writer and a fellow student at the school Dostoevsky attended. He wrote that Dostoevsky advised him to read Hoffman's Cattermole and De Quincey's Confessions of an English Opium Eater. I want to read both of them, one because of the cat, and the other one, well, the other books that contained a drug in the title that I read were surprisingly good, so I want to see if there's a pattern here. Although I know that Cattermole and The Magnetizer had a special place in Dostoevsky's heart, last month I read Little Tsahes, which I adored, and The Golden Pot, which was very trippy. I'll talk about them in the wrap-up, but if you want to read something fun, something that could be made into a political satire, if you like fantasy elements and dragonflies, Do try a little tzatzikis. Imagine every time you did something good, your merits would be attributed to this little tzatzikis, and every time he did something bad, you would be blamed for it. Well, that's a superpower. In his introduction to the stories of Edgar Allan Poe, Dostoevsky praised his power of imagination, but added that Hoffman was superior to him. There's something magical and mysterious about his stories, but there's also some humor and some depth to them. You can see his influence on The Queen of Spades by Pushkin, who in turn influenced other Russian writers. And I think that his impact on Gogol is clear as well. Dostoevsky read Hoffman when he was 16. I don't know about his other works, but he definitely read the life and opinions of Tomcat Moore in German. He also watched the play The Robbers by Schiller when he was 10, and he later said that it had a profound effect on his spiritual development. He admired both his poetry and his plays, which he read in the original German and in Russian. You can see Schiller's influence most of all in The Brothers Karamazov, where you can find many quotes from his works. But his name comes up a lot in Dostoevsky's works, and it usually stands for purity and idealism, as far as I could tell. To be honest, Don Carlos and The Robbers were a bit disappointing, because my expectations were just unrealistic. I knew how much Dostoevsky loved them, but oh well. Dostoevsky's debut wasn't supposed to be his novel Poor Folk or his translation of Eugénie Grandet, but actually a historical play. It would have been Mary Stuart or Boris Godunov, but the manuscripts haven't survived and we know very little about them. We do know that Mary Stuart was inspired by Schiller and Boris Godunov by Pushkin, but that's about it. If you decide to start your literary career by trying to imitate one of your favorite writers, then consider this a sign. It's safe to say that Dostoevsky's reading helped him to create, at least this was his perspective at the time. He thought that Schiller became a part of Russian society and influenced it in the early 19th century. We can see one of the most well-known quotes from another German romantic, Goethe, in A Gentle Creature and The Brothers Karamazov. It's the same quote from Mephistopheles' line, "I am part of that power which eternally wills evil and eternally works good." In his notes for The Diary of a Writer, Dostoevsky asked, "What is the difference between a demon and a man?" And he concluded that, unfortunately, the man could say the opposite of Mephistopheles' words. He could say that he wants good, but his actions result in evil. Gretkin from The Double met a dog in the street, which looked at him with timid comprehension. Then suddenly a memory came back into his mind. Then he called the dog horrid, and he couldn't understand why he did it. Since we're talking about Goethe, you probably understand that I'm implying that the thing Galetkin remembered came straight from Faust. If Dostoevsky mentioned that the dog was a black poodle, it would have been even clearer. While his friend didn't notice anything strange about the dog, to Faust it appears in a different light. Faust appeared in The Adolescent as well, as a musical fantasy about Gretchen. Dostoevsky usually changed the text he mentioned so that they would fit into his own work. Dostoevsky also read Goethe's Reineke Fuchs, and he asked his brother to translate it into Russian. Mikhail Dostoevsky wanted his brother's big novels to resemble Wilhelm Meister's apprenticeship. German Romanticism in general had an influence on Dostoevsky's works, but so did the French writers such as George Sand, Balzac, Hugo, and others. I mentioned in my anti-TBR videos that I wasn't going to read George Sand because I wasn't too impressed by her works in the past. Well, Dostoevsky loved her. He translated La Dernière Aldini in 1844, but then discovered that it had already appeared in Russian. Oops! In his own words, an unpleasant incident happened to him. Apparently, he also mentioned the Uskok, Jeanne, La Marquise, Lucrezia Floriani, and Spiridione. If you're not into French literature, you might be asking, what are these? And I don't know yet, but she was extremely popular at the time, that's for sure. Perhaps some of Dostoevsky's characters were inspired from her works, because according to him, she portrayed proud heroines, true sovereigns, and He liked to call his own heroines proud, so who knows? I wish I could tell you more about Roxane's influence on Dostoevsky, but I haven't explored this topic yet. He called her the most Christian woman of her age, which, coming from him, would be a compliment. The next writer who just had to be on this list is Balzac. As I mentioned, Dostoevsky's first literary publication was his translation of Eugénie Grandet. Apparently, in his translation, he changed the original text quite a lot. Improved it, if you will. Removed certain words, added others, changed different elements for no apparent reason. But I guess his creative side couldn't resist improving the work of someone he admired, to add more contrast, maybe. Anyway, he was really pleased with his work, but thank God he focused on his own writing. He read and reread everything by Balzac, and I assume he enjoyed most of his works. Even in his letters, you can find so many quotes from them. It's amazing. You know, out of all the writers I read in the past months, I'm the most grateful for Balzac. And I was even more reluctant to pick him up than Don Quixote, which says a lot. I read two other books of his a few years ago, and I didn't fall in love. All the stereotypes about him, his infamous verbosity, seemed true at the time. Well, now, having read Lost Illusions and The Wild Ass's Skin, really unfortunate translation, by the way, I can finally appreciate his writing. I don't know what happened, but I just fell under his spell. Why would you want him to stop the sentence when it's so elegant and smooth? I reread a couple of pages from one of his novels a few times because his writing was just so beautiful. I do reread paragraphs if I like them, but pages, that's something new. In case I haven't talked about this enough in my other videos, if you enjoyed Crime and Punishment, you'll probably like Père Goriot as well. There's a scene in both of them, a dialogue between two people. One of them asks the other something along the lines of, would you kill a mandarin or an old moneylender to get a lot of money? This sort of part question, part temptation appears in many of Dostoevsky's works, and it's a great way to reveal something unexpected about a character, something you wouldn't hear in a casual conversation, for instance. But please don't expect the same style or even themes. This was the first book Dostoevsky reread with his wife when she confessed she hadn't read any Balzac. The Wild Ass's Skin is about a young man with an awesome name, Raphael de Valentin, who wants to kill himself, but decides to enter a shop instead. Why not? He discovers something interesting there. Well, it's in the title, there's no point in hiding it from you, is it? It's a kind of cautionary tale, but it's so much more than that, really. Lost Illusions is what I thought Great Expectations was going to be. It contains great tips for journalists and people who review books, among other things. I have to warn you, in both of these novels, as well as in Dostoevsky's works, there are people with suicidal tendencies, but Balzac isn't as dark as Dostoevsky. After his mock execution, Dostoevsky wrote a letter to his brother Mikhail, and he quoted from The Last Day of a Condemned Man by Hugo. Different elements from the novel will later appear in Crime and Punishment and Demons. It was also mentioned in the preface to A Gentle Creature, one of Dostoevsky's best works in my opinion. He called Hugo's novel a masterpiece, and I think it means a lot coming from someone who was actually condemned to death. Notre Dame de Paris was mentioned or alluded to in The House of the Dead, Crime and Punishment, The Idiot, and The Brothers Karamazov. For Dostoevsky, Quasimodo was the embodiment of the oppressed, despised, dumb, and disfigured. He wrote this in his own preface to Notre Dame de Paris, which he published in the journal Time. Les Misérables came out at the same time as Crime and Punishment, and many Russian intellectuals believed that Crime and Punishment was better. Dostoevsky disagreed. I argued with all of them, and I showed them that Les Misérables was superior to my work, and I argued sincerely from the bottom of my heart, for I was sure of it and still am, despite the general opinion of all our experts. You can see the contrast between the Russians and the Europeans in a lot of his works, including The Gambler. One of the Westerners in The Gambler was named after an extremely naive and idealistic character. I'm talking about Des Grieux, whose name sends the readers to Manon Lescaut. So I read it last month. Just to be clear, I didn't read it just because Dostoevsky mentioned it in his novel, but also because it was scandalous. Now it seems harmless and silly, but I don't think that most of us can actually understand these characters. The heroine has full control over her lover's life, but she has no sense of morality, no introspection. Her lover seems to be blind to all her faults. He has another Manon, not the one of the flesh, but the one of the spirit. There's something to be said about his power of faith in his ideals. He doesn't let her actions in this material world affect his love for her in a negative way. Most of the time, people don't care if you suffer from your own mistakes, but this isn't the case with this guy. He cares a lot. On the one hand, I wanted to shout at him, "You fool, what are you doing?" But on the other, I wanted him to learn a lesson. It's no coincidence that this novel appears in The Lady with the Camellias by Alexandre Dumas-Fils. It's no coincidence that Mademoiselle Blanche from The Gambler has something in common with this Manon. It's the same lack of control over her passions, in this case it's money. And self-destruction is another theme that unites the two novels. It's a surprisingly easy read, it's fast-paced, but do expect to meet some very annoying characters. You might have heard that Raskolnikov from Crime and Punishment and Dolgoruki from The Adolescent have been compared to Julien Sorel from The Red and the Black by Stendhal. As far as I know, Dostoevsky never mentioned this book in his notes or letters, though virtually every other notable French novel was at least alluded to, from a copy of Madame Bovary in Nastasia Philipovna's room in The Idiot, to various allusions to Eugène Sue, Soulier, Nodier, and many others. Paul de Kock is another writer who is mentioned repeatedly in Dostoevsky's works, though not in the best light. Ladies shouldn't read Paul de Kock. I don't know why he was the scapegoat for all the indecent French literature, but he was mentioned in Poor Folk, The Village of Stepanchikova, and in Demons. In The Idiot, when Aglaya insists that she's not a small child, she uses the fact that she read Paul de Kock as an argument. Apparently, if you read him, you'll know about everything, and if you told your mother you read him, she would faint. He was quite a prolific writer, so if you could recommend something from him, that would be great. In his youth, Dostoevsky was introduced to 16th and 17th century French writers, such as Ronsard, Malherbe, Racine, and Corneille. Later, when he was 19, he wrote to his brother Mikhail. But tell me, if you please, on the subject of form, what has possessed you to say that neither Racine nor Corneille can please us because their form is bad? You miserable wretch! Racine, the ardent, the passionate, a man in love with the ideal, has no poetry? And someone can suggest this? But have you read Andromaque? Have you read Brother? Have you read Iphigenie? If you like the movie The Killing of the Sacred Deer, and Greek and Roman tragedies, especially Phaedra and Iphigenia, not sure about the English pronunciation, then you might enjoy Racine's plays. I haven't read the ancient versions, but I have read his, and I can say I was impressed by his writing, though I do realize how influential it was at the time. If you're opposed to reading plays and even Shakespeare didn't change your mind, then Racine's definitely not for you. His tragedies are so hardcore, for lack of a better word. The stakes are really high, and even the female characters are more complex than you would imagine. I'm just more into Corneille. I found his language more accessible. They were writing in the 17th century after all, so just trying to get what they meant requires more effort at first. To give you a synopsis of Racine's play, Phèdre is the second wife of Thésée, and she is in love with her stepson. This is killing her, she is absolutely obsessed. The problem is, her husband, the king, is away, and it's rumored that he died, so this would make her free to marry someone else. I'll let you discover for yourself how the story develops, but don't be fooled by the simplicity of the premise. It's more interesting than it seems at first. Iphigenie is Agamemnon's daughter, and she has to be sacrificed so that the Greeks could go to Troy. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Well, Agamemnon's wife and his daughter are summoned for his daughter's marriage to Achilles. Spoiler, not really. It's a trap. They're actually summoned for the sacrifice. Obviously, Agamemnon doesn't want this, so he sends them a letter telling them not to come. Guess what? They came. There's a lot of confusion and misunderstanding in the following acts. Misunderstandings on different levels. How are you supposed to deal with this? You don't sacrifice your daughter for the greater good so that the Greeks could win the war? For me, this play had the potential to become something truly great, but it didn't. I don't know why, really. Maybe because certain ideas weren't developed enough. Corneille, on the other hand, and his play Le Cid is a whole nother story. What does Romanticism want if its highest ideal are not shown in Le Cid? I couldn't agree more, and it's difficult to explain why I enjoyed it as much as I have, because it's not as if I found something new in there. It's a tragic comedy based on a Spanish play, which was based on a legend. If I had to compare it to something in terms of plot, the most obvious choice would be Romeo and Juliet. There are lovers, there's a feud between their families, but the style and the characters are different, though they're just as memorable. In the same letter, Dostoevsky wrote that a play like Cinna would have done honor to Shakespeare. Speaking of whom, surprise, Shakespeare is the ghost that haunts every good author who came afterwards, at least this is the impression I got. Dostoevsky read his works when he was pretty young, but he reread them periodically. As you might have guessed, he was particularly interested in Hamlet. In the notebooks for the adolescent, one of the first lines is a Christian Hamlet. But here's what Dostoevsky wrote to his brother when he was 16. How petty is man, Hamlet, Hamlet. When I think of his moving wild speeches, in which resounds the groaning of the whole numbered universe, there breaks from my soul not one reproach, not one sigh. That soul is then so utterly oppressed by grief that it fears to grasp it so as not to tear itself apart. Even if we ignore all the references to Shakespeare's works, and you can find a lot of them, especially from his tragedies, we can't deny that he meant a lot for Dostoevsky. But how much is a lot? Well, he read him in the Peter and Paul fortress, and he thanked his brother for sending his works. One of the things that surprised me the most when I was trying to understand Shakespeare's influence on Dostoevsky was the fact that initially the idiot had something in common with Othello. I read the description of a scene that was written in the notebooks for the idiot. It was a very short and graphic explanation, but I would have never thought of making this connection. I won't read it to you because it would reveal how the novel didn't end. Shakespeare's place and characters are mentioned here and there in Dostoevsky's works. We can see the ghost from Hamlet in Humiliated and Insulted, Othello in Demons, Romeo in Crime and Punishment, and Shakespeare himself in The Uncle's Dream, and so on. In Notes from Underground, there's an ironic line, something like, "Finally, they came to the conclusion that Shakespeare is immortal." Apparently, back then, this was just as cliched as it is now. Here's what Dostoevsky wrote much later in the Notebooks for Demons. On Shakespeare, this is non-tendacious and eternal, and it has survived. This is not a simple reproduction of everyday life, which, as many scholars assert, exhausts the whole of reality. The whole of reality is not exhausted by everyday life, for a huge part of it is present in it in the form of a still latent, unexpressed future word. From time to time, they appear prophets who divine and express this integral word. I could provide more quotes, but I think you get the idea. I read Shakespeare both in English and translation. The translations make his works a bit more informal, is the first word that comes to mind. I'm glad that I got used to his English though. Both with Shakespeare and Dostoevsky, you can feel that you're reaching the edge of something, and I guess this is the reason they're still widely read and recommended. I still think that discussing their works in class with people who aren't truly passionate about them isn't the best idea. Thankfully, I got to read and interpret some of Shakespeare's works before I had to study them in an academic setting. I have yet to read Julius Caesar, Richard III, and King Lear. These are the ones that interest me the most at the moment, but I keep them for dessert when I need something really good. In 1840s, Dostoevsky also read Diderot, Rousseau, and Voltaire, and he expressed his interest in their writing even later in 1869. I don't know if they had a direct influence on his writing, though. Rousseau plays a role in Notes from Underground, and there's also an allusion to him in The Adolescent. Something about him being an exhibitionist. I think all these guys have awesome names, but their works are quite difficult to read. Rousseau's Julie and Amy are among the most tedious books I've ever read. I hope that his confessions are better. Voltaire's Candide would have been better as a nonfiction book, in my opinion, and his Micromegas wasn't too impressive either. Diderot's Jacques le Fataliste was a bit better, in my opinion. I thought it was somewhat innovative, though it could be very annoying at times. I think you would enjoy it if you are patient enough and if you like postmodernism. When we had to discuss this in class, the teacher confessed that he couldn't finish it for some reason. He wasn't the type, so you've been warned. Since we talked about Dostoevsky's love for the human comedy, another book that you'd expect to find on this list, and rightly so, would be Dante's Divine Comedy. House of the Dead is the first thing that comes to mind when I think of Dostoevsky and the Divine Comedy. Even the title is suggestive. I think it's fair to compare labor camps to hell. It was also mentioned in The Brothers Karamazov and probably somewhere else, but the allusion wasn't as obvious to me. He definitely thought that Dante managed to capture the essence, the spirit of his time, while also creating a masterpiece. I read The Divine Comedy in high school, and back then I thought it was the most difficult book ever. I blame the translation and the fact that I read all the footnotes, at least in the Inferno. I had to know who was who and why Dante placed them there and what was the inspiration for this and that. I wouldn't recommend to look these things up. The text itself should be enough at first, at least. Although I did enjoy it to some extent, I won't reread it in the near future because the memory of struggling so much with it is still fresh. So you could just go blind into it. Dante and Virgil will guide you anyway. I enjoyed the concept of this journey and the style much more than the content itself. It still remains one of the most interesting books I've ever read. Another classic Dostoevsky praised was Homer. In the Iliad, Homer gave the ancient world an organization of life which is both spiritual and earthly in the same sense as Christ gave one to the new world. In case this isn't obvious, comparing someone to Jesus was a big deal in Dostoevsky's case. I don't see how Homer affected his writing style, though. The same goes for other ancient writers like Thucydides, Tacitus, Flavius, Pliny, Plutarch, Diodorus, and Herodotus. Dostoevsky was definitely interested in their works, but I don't know what he thought about them, and I haven't read any of them myself except Homer. I talked mostly about Western European writers. I left the Russians for the next part. Pushkin, Gogol, Karamzin, Lermontov, Zhukovsky, and others will have to wait. I could also discuss the nonfiction books if you'd be interested in that. But for now, thank you so much for watching. Bye!